and welcome to The Chemistry Solution. The tutorial that I made on balancing chemical equations is probably the most popular tutorial that I've put together, and so I decided to expand on this a little bit for anybody who's still confused. This video has a couple harder examples, and it also has some equations with polyatomic ions, and I just wanted to show you a trick on how to balance chemical equations when you have polyatomic ions in your formulas. So if you are completely confused on how to balance chemical equations, go back and watch the first video I did that's just called Balancing Chemical Equations. And if you're ready for the second video here, remember that to balance a chemical equation, we need to have the same number of atoms on each side of the equation. And we do that by changing the coefficients in front of the compounds, never changing the subscripts because that would alter the substance that you have. That would make it something different. We are going to just jump right into some examples here. So let's go ahead and balance the following equation. The first thing you want to do is you want to know exactly how many of each type of atom you have on each side of the reaction arrow. So on our reactant side, we have 2 nitrogen and 5 oxygen. And over on the product side, we have 1 nitrogen atom. And then we have 2 oxygen atoms from the NO2 plus another 2 oxygen atoms from the O2 for a total of 4 oxygen atoms. Now you can balance these equations starting with any element you want, but generally it's easier to start with an element that is just in one compound on each side of the reaction arrow. So I'm going to go ahead and start with nitrogen. So I have 2 nitrogen atoms on the reactant side. I only have 1 on the product side, so in order to get 2 nitrogen atoms on the product side, I'm going to put a 2 in front of NO2. Remember, this means that I now have 2 molecules of NO2 on my product side. So this changes the number of nitrogen atoms to 2. And then because I have 2 molecules of NO2, that's 2 oxygen atoms in each of those, so a total of 4 oxygen atoms from the 2 molecules of NO2, plus another 2 oxygen atoms just from the O2 on the product side. So a total of 6 oxygen atoms. Now, this problem looks pretty easy at first, and it's really not too hard as we continue to go through this, but you'll notice that we've balanced the nitrogen atoms, and now we have this weird problem with the oxygen. We have 5 oxygen atoms on the reactant side and 6 oxygen atoms on the product side. So you have an odd number on one side and an even number on the other side, and that may seem a little tricky to balance at first. So every now and then when you do these problems, you kind of need to go back and forth a little bit. I'm going to say the first thing that maybe we'll try to change here is to at least get an even number of oxygen atoms on the reactant side. So I'm going to go ahead and put a 2 in front of N2O5. Now you'll notice though that's going to change the number of nitrogen atoms on this side. So we had our nitrogen balanced and now we're kind of throwing that off again. So if we have 2 molecules of N2O5, so 2 nitrogens in each of those 2 molecules, that gives us a total of 4 nitrogen atoms on the reactant side. And then again, if we have 2 molecules of N2O5, 5 oxygen atoms in each of those molecules, that gives us a total of 10 oxygen atoms on the reactant side. Sometimes when you're balancing equations, it seems like you're just going back and forth and you're not really getting anywhere. And if this process is taking you forever, then there is a good chance that you might have made a mistake, so it's sometimes a good idea to go back and start over. But if you just have to go back and forth a couple of times, sometimes that's just what it takes to balance these equations. So since I've changed the number of nitrogen atoms on the reactant side, I'm going to go back and try to balance the number of nitrogen atoms. So I'm going to change the 2 in front of NO2 on the product side to a 4, and that will give us 4 nitrogen atoms on the product side. Now you'll notice this also changes the number of oxygen atoms. So we have 8 from the 4 molecules of NO2 plus another 2 oxygen atoms from the O2, which gives us a total of 10 oxygen atoms. So it may have seemed like we weren't quite getting anywhere, but now all of a sudden our reaction is balanced. So that was an example of a little bit harder of an equation to balance. Hopefully that was helpful to you. Now I want to show you how to balance an equation if you have a polyatomic ion. Now you can do this the exact same way that you were balancing equations before. You can count up the total number of each type of atom you have. But just to make your life a little bit easier, if you have a polyatomic ion on the reactant side and you have that same polyatomic ion on the product side, and that's important, it needs to be exactly the same. You can balance that polyatomic ion like it's one thing, so you don't have to separate it apart into its constitutive atoms. So if you look in this equation, you'll see that you have nitrate or NO3 on the reactant side, and you also have NO3 on the product side. So I'm going to count up the number of each type of atom I have on the reactant side and the product side, but I'm going to leave the nitrate for last. So on the reactant side, I have one lead, I have one potassium, and I have one iodine atom. Over on the product side, I have one lead, I have one potassium, and I have two iodine atoms. And then we see that nitrate group is exactly the same, so we can do this. We can keep it all together and count it just as one thing. And so if you look on the reactant side, you'll see that NO3 is in parentheses and the 2 is outside of parentheses. So that means that we have two nitrate groups there. And on the product side, you have NO3, you just have one nitrate group there. Like I said, if it makes you feel better to separate it out, you can do that, but this will just save you a little bit of time. So let's go ahead and start balancing. Lead is the same on each side. Potassium is the same on each side. And when I get to iodine, I notice I have one iodine atom on the reactant side and two iodine atoms on the product side. So I am going to put a 2 in front of Ki, or potassium iodide, on the reactant side. That is going to change the number of potassium and also change the number of iodine atoms. So now I have 2 potassium and I also have 2 iodine. To rebalance my potassium now, because now I have 2 potassium on the reactant side and only 1 on the product side, I'm going to put a 2 in front of KNO3, or potassium nitrate, on the product side. That will give me 2 potassium on the product side. And also because that 2 carries out throughout the whole formula, now I have 2 nitrate groups on the product side as well. Hopefully that was a little bit easier. This one wouldn't have been terrible if you separated the nitrogen atoms and the oxygen atoms, but let's look at one more example where things would have gotten a lot more complicated and where things would be a lot easier if you just keep your polyatomic ions together. If you look at this equation, you'll see that you have NO3, or nitrate, on the reactant side, and you also have it on the product side. Again, we're looking for the exact same formula, NO3 on each side. You also have SO4, or sulfate, on the reactant side, and you have SO4 on the product side. Now, especially when you have polyatomic ions that contain similar atoms, like nitrate and sulfate, both contain oxygen, this is where it's really handy to just keep those polyatomic ions together. So if I look at my equation, I have one sodium and one copper atom on the reactant side. And over on the product side, there are 2 sodium atoms and 1 copper atom. And then I'm going to keep my nitrate groups together. So on the reactant side, I have 1 group of NO3. Over on the product side, I have 2 groups of NO3. And then I also have sulfate on both sides. So on the reactant side, I have 1 group of SO4, and on the product side, I have 1 group of SO4. Especially in this example, if you keep these polyatomic ions together, it makes the equation really easy to balance. So I'm going to start with sodium. I have 1 sodium atom on the reactant side and 2 on the product side, so I'm going to go ahead and put a 2 in front of the sodium nitrate on the reactant side. Now that changes the number of sodium atoms to 2, and it also changes the number of nitrate groups to 2. And so an equation that looked fairly complicated to start out with turned out to be actually pretty simple to balance. Thanks for watching The Chemistry Solution. If there are other topics you'd like to see covered in the future, please feel free to email me at missy, that's M-I-S-S-Y, @thechemistrysolution.com. Thanks.